A producer's role is even, you know, it's a lot more spread out, I would say. And in today's world, different producers play different roles.
Mm-hmm.
So, for example, a producer's role is to organize the money to make the film.
Mm-hmm.
A producer's role is also to creatively collaborate with the director to get the best out to kind of achieve the combined vision of everyone. Now, a guy who's arranging for money may not have that expertise creatively, and the creative guy might not have the expertise of going out to the market and raising the money. But that doesn't mean these roles are divided in every film. They could be in one person, they could be in multiple.
Welcome to another episode of The Brand Called You, a podcast and podcast show that brings you leadership lessons, knowledge, experience, and wisdom from hundreds of successful individuals from around the world. If you're new to our channel, please consider subscribing to it and hit the bell icon so that you never miss an update. I am your host, Ashutosh Garg, and today I'm privileged and delighted to welcome someone from Bollywood, Mr. Vivek Agarwal. Vivek, welcome to the show.
Hi, Ashutosh.
Vivek is the head of content and development and production at Reliance Entertainment. He is a multi-award-winning passionate director and producer of cinema. And earlier, he has spent time with Phantom Films as the head of operations and overseen 15 feature films. So Vivek, let's talk about your journey as a film producer. What got you started in the film business? It's very aspirational for every Indian.
I'm one of those lucky guys who kind of knew what I wanted to do when I was a kid. I get told by my school friends, and I still am in touch with quite a few of them, that when we were 14, 15, I think ninth grade or something, we were all like sitting and chatting that what would each one of us do.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm born and brought up in South Bombay, so I'm in one of the schools out there, and apparently I wrote in our diary at that time that I want to be a filmmaker. I don't know why I did that at 15, mm-hmm. but I'm quite sure I knew that since then. And I did study film, to be honest. I did my master's in economics and stuff. But at 20, I started working. The day I turned 20, I went looking for a job. In a film production company while I was doing my commerce wow. education.
Mm-hmm.
And I was fortunate that I got a job on the first day. It was a menial job of being a production assistant. But it's been 27 years now, yeah.
Amazing. Amazing. So, you know, there's a lot of discussion that goes on what is the role of a director and the role of a producer. Help me understand this.
That's a very... It's a very interesting question, and very few people actually ask that.
Mm.
They assume that they know.
Yes.
A lot of what people assume is right, but if I was to put it very briefly to you, let's start with the role of a director. In simple terms, I would say it has a lot to do with people management,
okay.
and very less with being creative. As long as you know how to say a story, you're not verbally saying it, but you're kind of you're interacting with various people, whether it's actors, whether it's technicians, whether it's your cameraman, your production designer, your costume designer, and the other actors, well, your own assistants who are your assistant directors. It's about managing them and using them to say a story.
Okay.
So it's a lot to do with people management. Yes, it has. It has bits to do with being creative also. Now, a director not necessarily is the writer of every film.
Okay.
There are experts who are called writers, and once a director has identified a script that he wants to say, he then kind of gets into a narrative where everyone contributes.
Mm-hmm.
The writer contributes. The actor contributes. The cameraman contributes to get that vision out on screen. So I would say that's what a director does. I think I've kind of explained what. It's not that a director is telling an actor, okay, now smile or now cry or now laugh. I'm saying that's the scene and it's been discussed, and then the emotions or the action is done. It's a collaborative effort.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Coming to a producer's role, a producer's role is even, you know, it's a lot more spread out, I would say. And in today's world, different producers play different roles. Mm-hmm. So, for example, a producer's role is to organize the money to make the film. Mm-hmm. A producer's role is also to creatively collaborate with the director to get the best out to kind of achieve the combined vision of everyone. Now, a guy who's arranging for money may not have that expertise creatively, and the creative guy might not have the expertise of going out to the market and raising the money. But that doesn't mean these roles are divided in every film. They could be in one person, they could be in multiple people.
Right.
Beyond that, a producer also needs to be someone who knows what's the best way to distribute or get his film out. And then obviously the distribution takes it over.
Right.
But it's like having that business sense as to if I'm making a film, spending X amount of money with X actor, what is the best way to get it out? He needs to have that understanding too. But one of the biggest roles that a producer plays is identifying in what budget a film needs to be made, mm-hmm. and finally achieving it in that, as well as creatively helping the director achieve their combined vision. Which means it's not that the director decides every time that, oh, this is the place I want to shoot.
Right.
A producer with that aptitude could also suggest and recommend that this is the way to do it, or this is the place to shoot it, or these are the actors to bring on board. So it is a bit creative also from that front. But there are producers who don't play that role at all. They just arrange for the money and the director takes over.
I understand. So, you know, when I was reading about you, you have produced some incredibly iconic movies. Can you share for our viewers and listeners some of the movies that you have done?
Yeah, I can definitely talk about the films that we made under Phantom Films, which I was running since we started the company in 2011. Mm-hmm. And we were really lucky. Again, I'm using the word lucky to kind of have a great record of films that came out, which we all appreciated, you know, be it Queen, then Urta Punjab, there was Lutera, there was Masaan, there was Sacred Games that came later. There were also a few duds like Bombay Velvet and there was a film called Chandar. Then off late, we did Super 30 in 2019, which did really well. It was a great story.
It is.
So yeah. These were a few films that I have kind of worked on.
So, amazing. Yeah. So, you know, a follow-up question for you, Vivek, is what goes into making a good, successful film or web series?
Nice. So it's, again, a very, very good question.
Mm-hmm.
The most important thing, according to me, and I think the single most important factor to make a great film or a great series or a great piece of content is the energy. Mm-hmm. The energy when a lot of people come together, like I've kind of said before, that it's a collaborative effort to make films.
Mm.
And when the energy is right of all these people coming together is when you make a great film. To kind of expand on this, what I would say is, you know, someone would tell you that, oh, a great script is important to make a great film, or great actors can make a great film. But it's not true in every example, because a great script with great actors and a great director and a great producer can still make a dud. And there are lots of examples of that.
Absolutely right.
And similarly, a very average script with a first-time director could be a blockbuster film. Like I would say in the last 20 years, at least in Bollywood or in Indian cinema, I would say 70% of the biggest blockbusters have been made by first or second-time directors.
Wow.
And one can go into the maths of it and see it, but that's the way it is. It's those first or second time directors who go on to become celebrated people, and very few of them are able to kind of match the success that they've had in their first or second films. I don't know the reason for that. So yeah, to answer your question, it's the energy that is on that set when you're making a film, where everybody's collaborating, everybody who needs to have a voice has a voice, and you're just exchanging ideas and just great and happy in that atmosphere is what makes a great film.
Amazing. And, you know, again, a question that is often asked by all the people who watch is, how long does it take to make a film from the time it is conceived till it finally reaches me as a consumer of the show?
You know, this is one business where there are no set rules for a product to be made. Like, you know, you if you're in a manufacturing business and you're manufacturing a telephone or a car or a computer, there are timelines, there are processes, and you know, there's a development stage which is slightly longer, but then everything else falls into place with a with like a set timeline. That doesn't happen in films. And there can never be a standard timeline. It's a creative business, it's a creative process. From idea to script, again, you can't say ki teen mahine mein script likh lo. It won't happen like that. I'm saying it's an evolving process. It could take 3 days, 3 months, 3 years sometimes to get an idea into that perfect script. Once you have that script, you've either started casting it while you were writing it, if you're influential enough, or you have to take that written script to actors, then get it casted. And then you have to depend on actors' availabilities. Once you've got those actors available and you've done the analysis of cost of making that film, you might realize, oh, this is not cost effective at this budget. We need to rethink how to make this film. So again, the time gets stretched.
Right.
That you haven't even gone onto a shooting floor. So this time could be anything from a few months to a few years sometimes.
Wow.
Okay. Shooting a film, there's still a standard time average. I would say anything between 30 days to 100 days. You could average out about 50 days. And the bigger canvas films can take longer, sometimes 150, 200 days also. But I would say an average out of about 50, 55 days is decent to shoot a film. Post-production, again, is dependent on whether you have visual effects or you don't have. The visual effects work is less, the timeline is shorter. Otherwise, that could be unending again.
And I guess like any other project, irrespective of whether it's a movie or an industry, the longer it takes, the greater the costs.
That's a given, because there's just the cost of money is something which will escalate, as well as when a film takes longer to make, there are more people on board for a longer duration of time. So you that's where the costs go up.
So you know, Vivek, let's now move on. The pandemic has given a fresh lease of life to the OTT platforms and has impacted the cinema halls. And we have suddenly started to see a lot of top stars coming onto the OTT platforms. What are OTT platforms doing to filmmaking?
You know, they're not really doing anything to harm filmmaking.
Okay.
I'm saying that's a notion, that's a conversation I've been having quite often with a lot of people. I think it's just another medium to get content out. Like films are being made even directly for OTT. So if you're talking about films for the theatrical release and business, it's another medium. So for filmmakers, it's not harming them at all, because they actually have more work. Never has our industry been more busy than what it is today. Never have people got more work on their plate than today, whether it's technicians, whether it's actors, whether it's anybody.
So the canvas has become much bigger, you're saying.
Yeah, there's more work for every single body, and there's more place, there's more works, which is why there's place for more people to come in and join the industry.
Very interesting. And, you know, do you see a shift taking place now that suddenly I, as an audience, have discovered that I can see the same entertainment in the privacy of my home rather than go to theaters?
Sorry, can you just repeat that, please?
Do you think there's going to be a shift that will start to happen from the movie cinema halls to my home, because now I've discovered I can get the same quality in my house?
See, there will be a shift in the sense that there's more available to watch on your phone or your television set at home. And it's upon your personal choice where you want to watch it. Yes, there is more content being made to watch in the privacy of your room. There's more content being produced for that. So the options are far more. Economically, it will become tougher to make smaller films for the theatrical release. The big canvas films will get made, and people will enjoy them watching it in the theaters. So to answer your question, the shift is because there is more content available, more content can be produced to watch in the privacy of your room.
What a fascinating perspective. That, you know, I never thought of it like that. But what you're really telling me is that the entire industry has grown.
Yeah.
Because of OTT.
Multifold.
Yeah. Fantastic. But now let me come to a little bit of a ticklish problem that seems to be bothering the government a lot.
Yeah.
You know, there's a lot of noise being made on why or how should the OTT platform be regulated. And I, as a user, say, why should they be regulated? I'd love to get your perspective.
You know, this has been an issue over the last few months, I would say last couple of years. I don't have a definite opinion on this, but like, for example, there was a censorship that is prevalent in our country or in the world also on films of what can be seen publicly and what can't. I agree and I disagree with a lot of that because, yeah, obviously you cannot be showing pornographic stuff openly.
Yes.
To the general public.
Yeah.
But a lot of times what's also happening is the person who's heading that department or the institution that's kind of taking the calls on that, personal opinions come into play, which affects content that doesn't need to get affected. As much as I'm saying I'm for censorship, I'm also against it if someone's personal opinions keep coming out. The same applies even for content on OTT. Like, why should there be a different law for either? But at the same time, you say, okay, but this is something which you can watch privately. But that applies even for theaters, right? If you know it's a pornographic film, don't go and watch it if you're going to be embarrassed watching it. And obviously, kids will not be allowed. And what is going to stop kids from watching content that they're not supposed to watch at home? So, which is why you're saying let's censor that also. It's a bit convoluted, but I'm saying the more restrictions or the more regulations you put, the more questions will arise and the more complicated it will get. And there is no solution to that because I'm not saying, hey, aray, this is getting messy. I'm saying that who are the people who are taking the decisions for a far larger group of people, which is the audience? Then that question of, ki hum democracy mein reh rahe, then even that kind of is questioned and it goes into a loop. So, like, you know, there actually isn't an answer. It's just sensibility. Like, you know, common sense has to prevail out here for everyone.
Very well said. Very well said. So my next question to you is that, you know, Bollywood, web series, OTT, they really mirror what is happening in society.
Yeah.
And I've often said this, you know, I'm 64 years old, and I love my movies, etc. And you've seen the transition beginning to happen. What, in your opinion, is the regulation that the industry needs to do to be able to influence society? Because, you know, India as a society is getting, is large with lots of different views.
I don't think there should be regulations to kind of get some content out. Like you said, like, you started by saying that society gets influenced by the content. I'm saying it's vice versa also. It's both ways. The content that gets made is a reflection of what's going on in the society. And then society gets influenced by the content they make. So we just need to let it grow. We just need to let it happen. The kind of films that were made in the 50s were different from the ones in the 60s and then from the 70s and then from the 80s and then from today. And I also see that there's a cycle that happens, you know. There's certain kind of storytelling. It's said differently, but it kind of 20, 30 years back, again, later it comes back. So I think this intermingling of society and films, it should just happen seamlessly without any regulations. That's because they both kind of hold each other's hands in a way, and people are exposed to a lot more than what they would normally be.
Fascinating. So I've got one more question before I move to the next segment. And this is a question on music. You know, music, songs were an integral part or are an integral part of films.
Yes.
And yet I don't see them too much on the OTT platforms, in web series. Are the tastes of audience beginning to change a little bit? And music is now moving on to independent platforms?
You know, I haven't thought of this, now that you're asking, what comes to the top of my head immediately is, first, from a commercial factor, from a business perspective, I think there's a limitation that the OTT platforms feel in generating revenue by having music and songs on OTT shows, though I don't know how, because if they have music, they can definitely sell the rights and still earn revenue. Okay. But on films, what happens is India is largely driven by film songs. Mm. The pop music market isn't as big as it is in the West.
Mm.
Like I would say just in the north of India, Punjabi music is really big in terms of pop music, but otherwise the rest of India isn't. It's film music that works. And with film music, our audiences love to see their favorite actors
Correct.
Singing or enacting those songs.
Mm.
And then they kind of relate to those emotions and play it in their lives. And hence there's a big market for it because then people want to hear that music. I won't be surprised if music spreads into the OTT space also, because currently the OTT guys are not exploiting it commercially.
Mm-hmm.
Once they start doing that, I'm quite sure they will not hesitate in kind of having that music, because it's a cost to record that music, and then you got to shoot it also. I'm quite sure OTTs don't emphasize on it because there's no revenue earned from that music. But it's a great way to say stories. Like that's what I've grown up seeing in India. The reason why we have music is not because we like to see people sing and dance, but it's a great way of storytelling.
Absolutely right. Very well said. So Vivek, I'm going to now move to the last segment of our conversation.
Sure.
I have time for maybe three questions. So let me ask you my first question, which is that, you know, for someone who started in the film industry when you were 20 and you've been now working in there for the last, I think, 20 or 22 years. 27 years. What would you say are three key milestones or pivot points in your life or your career?
I would say the first pivotal point in my life was meeting my mentor.
Mm-hmm.
There's a gentleman called Ashok Mehta. He's no more. He died in 2012.
Okay.
He was a very, very senior cameraman.
Mm-hmm.
I met him in 1994 when I started working very early. And I kind of made him my mentor. And, mm-hmm. and I spent a long, like 6-7 years working with him
mm-hmm.
before I became a director. So he was a very big influence on me. The reason being that even today, when he's no more, if I'm in a sticky situation, I think of how he would think of solving that sticky situation, and I always get an answer. And also, I don't think I have a single day that goes by where I haven't thought about him in some fashion. So he's had that big an influence on me. He was a great man. He was not somebody who was educated, but he still became the best DOP, the best cameraman this country has ever seen.
Wow.
And till his 60s, when just before he died, I would always see him practicing his handwriting because he never went to school.
Mm.
And he would read his newspaper aloud because that would make his English better and stuff. And you know, I was just fascinated by this man because he achieved so much in life. If I could, like, not about saying that if I can achieve 10% of what he had, but he had that influence on me, which kind of made me a better person, you know. So that was a very crucial moment in my life. And I would say the second one was when I made my first film as a director called ICU, which didn't work at all commercially. It was a complete dud, and there were various reasons for that. Mm-hmm. Partly I would blame myself for it, and then I really wouldn't blame anyone else. Mm-hmm. But what happened with that film had a big impact on me too. It was 10 years after I had kind of joined the industry,
mm-hmm.
and I had a certain way that I was looking at work. And post that, I kind of shifted gears completely to then not look back till now. I can't think of a third moment, but I think the third moment is still to happen to me.
No worries, no worries. It's still waiting to happen, I'm sure.
Yeah.
So moving on, for someone who's seen so much success, and in your own words, you've also had some challenges with some of your movies. As you look back at life from where you stand today, what does success mean to Vivek?
I've thought of this several times, and you know, there's just one answer that comes to me.
Mm.
You know, for me, success is about earning goodwill, I would say. We normally define success with the amount of money we've earned, or a bank balance, or houses, or hits and flops. I think it's more about, for me, it's about goodwill, where if I know that I've been good with people in general, and people think good about me because of my contribution to their lives,
mm-hmm.
I think that's my biggest success. And the money will come and go, but sure, this goodwill is something which, you know, if you built it, if you've earned it, it doesn't go away. Like I was told by my mentor very early in my career that, and that's what stayed with me, that Vivek, if you earn goodwill in your life, you know, you will never sleep hungry. But if you're going to run after money, there'll be a time that money will disappear, might disappear. And then what are you going to do? That's not going to feed you. But goodwill can feed you.
Well said. Well said. So I've got time for one more question. And my last question is, for all the creative work that you keep doing, who or what inspires you?
People.
Mm-hmm. And people as in?
Sorry?
People as in?
So I get inspired by stories of people, people that I work with, or people that I know about, or people that I hear about, or people that I read about. People's stories inspire me more than anything else. Individual stories. It's not about being successful. It's not about successful people who kind of earned it all or kind of written it all. It's small, small stories. Like, for example, there is this crane attendant whom I've known for 27 years since I started working, and he died last year. But he inspired me because he lived in a chawl. He'd known me since I was 20. He must have been about 10, 12 years older than me. But he became a friend, and he just hung around for like my 27 years. Wherever I was, I invariably used to bump into him. And just his passion towards what he did, and he earned, I think in the early days, it was 30, 40 bucks a day, and then it became like $1,000 a day. But that's what his earning was all his life. But just his dogged resilience to keep working every day and be a happy person inspired me every day of my life.
Amazing. Amazing. Vivek, thank you so much. It's been such a pleasure talking to you. Thank you for taking me through this incredible journey that you have had.
Thanks. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you for listening to The Brand Called You videocast and podcast, a platform that brings you knowledge, experience, and wisdom of hundreds of successful individuals from around the world. Do visit our website, www.tbcy.in, to watch and listen to the stories of many more individuals. You can also follow us on YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Just search for The Brand Called You.